Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
Day by day, and with each passing moment, strength I find to meet my trials here, trusting in my Father's wise bestowment. I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives unto each day what he deems best. Lovingly, it's part of pain and pleasure, mingling toil with peace and rest. Every day the Lord himself is near me, with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares he fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power, the protection of his child and treasure, is a charge that on himself he laid. As your days, your strength shall be in measure. This the pledge to me he made. Help me then in every tribulation, so to trust thy promises, O Lord, that I lose not faith's sweet consolation offered me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meeting, e'er to take as from a Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till I reach the promised land. Till I reach the promised land.
Desire of Ages, the chapter about the crisis in Galilee, and on page 392, on page 388 is where I read, where it says that when we receive the Holy Spirit into the heart, that is the beginning of life eternal. If you receive the Holy Spirit, life eternal has already begun to you. Now, for you, you might go to sleep in Jesus, but life eternal has already begun for you, and if you go to sleep in Jesus before the second coming, when he comes, you will take up that life again. If you have not received the Holy Spirit, you have no assurance of eternal life. There will be no one from this world that gains eternal life that has not received the Holy Spirit in this life. And then in that same chapter, on page 392, this is in Desire of Ages, the chapter on the crisis in Galilee, she talks about how these people, that was at the feeding of the 5,000, when everybody is excited, and of course they became very excited at that time, they saw that Jesus could solve every problem they had. They saw that if they went in a war against the Romans and he was along, he could heal the injured and he could provide food for the army, and they would have to win. They could take over the world, and that's what they wanted to do. But the next day, The next day in the synagogue in Capernaum, Jesus gave them a sermon. You can read the sermon. It's one of the sermons that Jesus gave that is recorded in the Bible. It's recorded in John 6. And in that sermon, they realized that Jesus had not come to give them so much some physical blessing, but he wanted to give them a spiritual blessing that in order to receive it, they would need to make a complete change in their life. They would have to practice self-denial. And that they were not willing to do. And Ellen White goes on to say, you can read it, you look up in Desire of Ages, page 392. She goes on to say that the same thing is happening today. And people say, when we talk, when we read all the wonderful promises about the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit can do in your life, it can answer every need that you have. People say, yes, that's what I want. Until they find out that in order to receive the Holy Spirit, they need to make a complete change in their life. Well, then all of a sudden, it's not so desirable anymore. Remember, I told you the story this morning about that New Age couple that came to the meeting, and they heard the gospel, and they accepted Christ as their Savior, and they became Christians. They were given a Bible. And as soon as she opened it, what happened? She found she was living in sin. Slammed it shut. Don't want to read that book anymore. But she was curious, so she opened it again. And every time she would open it, her sin was pointed out. And she'd close it. But finally, she was listening to the pleading voice of the Holy Spirit, and she decided to make a complete change in her life. Now, the man involved did not decide to do that. He decided that he was not going to make a complete change in his life, so that's why they had to separate. So, in order for me to receive the Holy Spirit, I have to be willing to make some changes in my life. And if I'm not willing to make the changes, then I can't receive the Holy Spirit. Now, that's not only true for an individual like myself. That's true for a whole group of individuals, a church. If the Holy Spirit starts speaking to people in the church saying, you need to do this, you need to change this, and they're not willing, well, then the Holy Spirit can't be revealed in power in that church. And the Holy Spirit will never be able to be revealed in power in that church unless either those individuals change their mind and are willing to make the changes, or unless they're removed from the church. Is the Lord going to remove some people from the church in the last days? Yes, He is. We're going to read a few things about that. I want to read quickly some of the statements that I read this morning that show us under what conditions the Holy Spirit cannot abide with us. I am very interested in these things because I want the Holy Spirit to abide with me. Do you want the Holy Spirit to abide with you? Well, if I find out I have some of these characteristics, then I have to say, well, Lord, I want these things to be changed in my life so the Holy Spirit can be with me. Here's one. Now, this is a hard one. I didn't read this morning. This is from volume 3, page 391. The Spirit of God cannot abide with those to whom He has sent the message of His truth, but who need to be urged before they can have any sense of their duty to be co-workers with Christ. That's a very interesting statement. It's talking about people, they have received the gospel, they claim to be Christians, but if they're actually going to do any missionary work, somebody has to urge them to do it or else they'll never do it. She says the Holy Spirit cannot abide with a person like that. That's something we all need to think about. Do I have to be urged to do something to share my faith, or am I looking for a way to share my faith? Or does somebody has to talk me into it? If somebody has to talk me into it, the Holy Spirit can't abide with me. One of the main reasons the Holy Spirit is given is so that you can be a witness for Christ. That's what it says in Acts 1:8. Well, if I have to be urged in order to witness for Christ, the Holy Spirit can't abide with me. Here is one that I did read this morning. This is found in many different places. I'm reading from Signs of the Times in 1884, but this statement appears in many places in the Ellen White writings. The willful commission of a known sin silences the witnessing voice of the Spirit and separates the soul from God. Jesus cannot abide in the heart that disregards the divine law. So, I was thinking through, can a person be saved if they die in sin? Now, don't answer. That's a trick question. I'm not trying to trick you. I'm trying to get you to think. We usually say that a person cannot be saved if they die in sin. Actually, that's not true. A person can be saved if they die in sin. There will be millions of people in heaven that never kept the Sabbath because they never knew about it. But that was a sin of ignorance. You can be saved if you die in a sin of ignorance. You cannot be saved if you die in a willful or a deliberate sin. This is what she's talking about here. There are people in the world still today that are committing sins of ignorance, but they're living up to all the light they have, and the Holy Spirit can be leading them. But if I know something is wrong and I do it, that silences the voice of the Holy Spirit in my soul. Jesus cannot live in my heart, and my soul is separated from God. Here's a third one. We read this one this morning. This is the one I said was written to a mother concerning how she was dealing with her children. Constant fault-finding is wrong, and the Spirit of Christ cannot abide in the heart where it exists. Well, that's something we need to pay attention to, especially if we have to deal with children, but even with adults. People get discouraged. Even adults can get discouraged with constant fault-finding. Here's a similar one. This was written to a physician. I read this morning. We are not to allow our perplexities and disappointments to eat into our souls and make us fretful and impatient. Let there be no strife, no evil thinking or evil speaking, lest we offend God. My brother, if you open your heart to envy and evil surmising, the Holy Spirit cannot abide with you. So, see, the Holy Spirit has to do, receiving the Holy Spirit has to do with the feelings that I have in my heart. Not just my thoughts, not just my actions, but my feelings. The feelings that I have, not just to the people in my family, but the feelings that I have to the people in the church where I go or to the people where I work. I'm going to read you a statement about this. If my feelings are wrong toward other people, the Holy Spirit cannot work in my behalf. I'll read that. This is 5 manuscript releases. We should not allow any feelings to come into our hearts against any of our brethren. For this is not the Spirit of Christ. It is not the principle of truth to be finding fault and thinking evil of our brethren. If there are any difficulties that arise in your midst, seek every way that you can to adjust them. This is your Christian duty. You may think that your brother is holy, that is completely in the fault. But if your brother does not come to you, you must go to him and try to come together. You must be in harmony. Unless you are in harmony with another, Christ cannot abide in your heart. Will you bow before God in prayer every day and ask Him to let the light of the Holy Spirit come into your hearts, and do not cease pleading with God until every evil thought and feeling is overcome? Christ says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. How much of this work have you done? Should the spirit of confession come into the church, you would surely see of the salvation of God. This is something we need to think through and pray about. If we have feelings in our hearts against other people, hard feelings, if we have feelings in our hearts against other people in the church, then God can't work in that church. The Holy Spirit can't work in that church. These feelings create walls so that the Holy Spirit cannot work. Now, this is a very difficult thing to be discussing, isn't it? Because your feelings have to do with your inner self, your inner emotional makeup. And I don't know what your feelings are. That's not my business. You don't know what my feelings are. But the Holy Spirit knows what your feelings are, and the Holy Spirit knows what my feelings are. And if we have feelings against one another in a church, the Holy Spirit can't work. The Holy Spirit can't work. So, if that's the case, then that means that we all need to pray and say, Lord, help us so that we will have the correct feelings that we should have toward the people in our family and toward people in our church so that the Holy Spirit can work. What we have just covered, just that one thing, is enough to explain why the Holy Spirit cannot work in Adventist churches today. Just that one thing. That's enough. There's a huge problem that we need to fast and pray about. Now, there are some other things. I have some other statements here I think I won't read concerning the scribes and Pharisees and some of their problems. The Holy Spirit, of course, will bring unity. You probably, well, maybe you haven't heard the story. I think it was a conference president many, many years ago who was asked to come and anoint a lady. And so he traveled to the city where she lived. She was sick in bed. And when he came into her house and talked to her, he said to her, do you have any feelings? Is there any feelings between you and anybody in the world that shouldn't be there? He understood some things. Holy Spirit can't work for you if you have those feelings. Well, she didn't want to talk about it, and he said, well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to go out of your house, and I'm going to go for a walk. And while I'm gone for a walk, I want you to do anything that you need to do, anything you need to confess, anything there's feelings between you and somebody else, I want you to see that that's made right. So he went for quite a long walk. And when he came back, he said to this lady, now, are there any feelings? You have anything between you and any other human being? She said, no, I do not. I've made everything right. He said, all right. If there aren't any feelings between you and anyone else, I'm willing to anoint you. So he did. And it's very interesting what happened in that case. The Lord chose to heal that woman instantly when she was anointed. But the Lord can't work for us, friends, if we have feelings in our hearts against this one or that one or the other one. It's very interesting. I didn't bring the reference. I'd have to look it up, in fact. But Ellen White says that when Jesus went to the cross, he did not even have a murmuring thought or feeling. It's an astonishing statement. I was shocked when I read that. He did not have any thought or feeling, Lord, why are you allowing me to go through this? There was no murmuring thought or feeling. If we want the Holy Spirit to work in power among God's people, our feelings toward each other have to be correct. Now, when the Holy Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit is going to help us to come into perfect harmony and unity. And of course, a large part of the Christian world today is saying, that's exactly what we want. We want to come into harmony and unity. By the way, Adventists are saying this too. Are you all aware of the fact that there have been meetings between Adventist ministers and Lutheran ministers and see what points we can agree on, get together on? And so, whenever we talk about the Holy Spirit, receiving the Holy Spirit, and the unity that the Holy Spirit wants to bring, people say, well, yes, why don't we all unify? We've had Adventist physicians say within the last few months, they say, well, why are you people not with the conference? Why are you separate? Why don't we just all get together and go finish the work? Why can't we just do that? Well, let me read to you a statement that Elder Ralph Larson used to read over and over. I'm going to read a number of statements along this point. This is what Ellen White quoted Revelation 18, 1 and 2, and then she said this. She says, we have a testing message to give, and I am instructed to say to our people, unify, unify. But we are not to unify with those who are departing from the faith and giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. With our hearts sweet and kind and true, we are to go forth to proclaim the message, giving no heed to those who lead away from the truth. Well, okay, that's just a beginning point. We cannot unify with those that are teaching false doctrines or are giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. But there is more. If we are going to receive the Holy Spirit in power, not only is there going to have to be unity, but there's going to have to be separation at the same time. And I want to read several statements that talk about the separation that is absolutely necessary if we are going to receive the Holy Spirit with power. The people that receive the Holy Spirit in the last days will not be people that are coming into unity with everybody else in the ecumenical movement. This is a statement that Ellen White wrote clear back in 1850. She said, I saw that God wanted His people to be separated from the world. For wicked persons were the lawful prey of the enemy, and he would work through them in every way to perplex and destroy the saints. And if we were obliged to be in company with the wicked persons, we must watch, pray and watch every moment, lest we should partake of their spirit. For they corrupted the atmosphere where they were, and their very breath was darkness, and that the wicked would wax worse and worse, and we must cut loose from them and be free and free indeed. God does not want His people to mingle with the wicked more than they are obliged to. Now, the Apostle Paul had something to say about this. If you look in 2 Corinthians 6, this is what he says, starting in verse 14. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of God, of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch what is unclean. And I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. We're to be separate from the world. God wants to separate that which is precious from that which is vile. I'm going to read you a statement now about that. This was written in 1851. I saw that many, very many, had been truly converted through the influence of persons who were living in open violation of the commandments of God. So these people were truly converted, but they were converted by people who were breaking God's law. I saw that God would separate the precious from the vile. There would be truth or something from God to call for a decision, and the corrupt have no disposition to receive that call for a decision, but are separated from the precious by the precious receiving the truth. God will work in mysterious ways to save the true honest ones. Notice, God is going to separate people. Did Jesus say that there would be a separation in the last days? Yes, he did. That's what the parable of the wheat and the tares is all about. There is going to be a separation in the last days. We're going to read just how that separation of the wheat and tares is going to occur. God is going to separate the precious from the vile, and how is it going to happen? We read in the statement how it is going to happen. God is going to send a message of truth, and some people will accept it, and some people will not accept it. The truth is what separates people into different groups in the last days. That's a very important point. There are some people that think that the way people are separated is they're separated into different organizations. That is not the issue. Now, I don't want to get into the whole area of the church, except just to tell you briefly, when you come right down to the end, it actually is not going to matter what denomination you belong to. Now, that's heresy to a lot of people, but I can read you that from the Spirit of Prophecy. What she says, she's talking about the time of the latter rain, the loud cry, and denominational distinctions are not going to mean anything at that point. What is going to mean something? It's the truth. The truth is what's going to separate people. People will accept truth and people will reject truth. The truth is what will separate. It's not whether you belong to this church or that church or another. That is not going to be the issue. The issue is going to be the truth. The truth will separate people into different groups. What truth is it that will separate everybody? Well, here's what it is. You can find statements like this in the book Early Writings about page 18, but I'm reading from a manuscript that Ellen White wrote in 1853. She says this, I then saw the third angel. What's the third angel? It's the angel in Revelation 14, 9 to 12. Said my accompanying angel, fearful is his word, awful is his mission. He is the angel that is to select the wheat from the tares. The third angel's message is going to do what? It's going to separate the wheat from the tares. In 1844 and 1845 and 1850, did the third angel's message separate the whole religious world into two groups? It most certainly did. Seventh-day Adventist Church developed out of the group of people back then that accepted the three angels' messages. However, now we have people that don't want to accept the three angels' messages that call themselves Adventists. See, the third angel is not done separating the wheat and the tares yet. The separation process is still going on. He is the angel that is to select the wheat from the tares and seal or bind the wheat for the heavenly garner. These things should engage the whole mind, the whole attention. Again, I was shown the necessity of those who believe we are having the last message of mercy being separate from those who are daily receiving or imbibing new error. I saw that neither young nor old should attend the assemblies of those who are in error and darkness. Said the angel, let the mind cease to dwell on things of no profit. So, the third angel's message, the three angels' messages, separates people into two groups. Now, as I have studied this subject about the third angel separating people into two groups, this separation process just keeps going on and on and on. There was a separation process that occurred in 1844. there was a separation process that occurred again in 1888. Now, we're talking about what is it that prevents us, that prevents Adventism from receiving the Holy Spirit in power. Do you know what Ellen White said happened as far as the Holy Spirit was concerned in 1888 in Minneapolis? Let me read it to you. I stated that the course that had been pursued at Minneapolis was cruelty to the Spirit of God. Are we going to receive the Holy Spirit if we're being cruel to the Spirit of God? Are we going to receive it? Well, what was going on there? I've got a whole bunch of material here, but I want to summarize it very, very briefly so we don't take lots and lots of time. There were two young ministers. One was 36 years old, one was 38 years old, that came and preached at the Minneapolis Conference. Their names were Jones and Wagner. You've heard those names probably. There were other people. Now, the president of the General Conference was sick, so that he wasn't able to be there. Uriah Smith, I believe, was there, editor of the Review and Herald. And the editor of the Review and Herald and the General Conference president resisted this message that these people brought. She mentions this here in this same manuscript. She says, I begged them to stop just where they were, but the position of Elder Butler and Elder Smith influenced them to make no change, but stand where they did. No confession was made. The blessed meeting closed, so forth. Then she says, the first step taken in the path of unbelief and rejection of light is a dangerous thing, and the only way for those who have taken this step to recover themselves from the snare of Satan is to accept that which the Lord sent them, but which they refused to receive. So she said, if you want to recover yourself, you're going to have to go right back, and you're going to have to accept what you refused to receive before. Now, remember, these brethren, Butler and Smith, they said, we need to stand by the old landmarks. And what was really behind that statement was, you shouldn't accept what these young upstart preachers are saying until it's been approved by the leadership, by the president of the General Conference and the editor of the Review and Herald and the leaders. You shouldn't accept it until it's been approved by the leadership. Now, is that okay or is that not okay? Can you receive the Holy Spirit when you have that kind of an attitude? Do you know what Ellen White says that they were doing when they made these statements? Do you know what she says they were doing? I would never make statements these strong. I'll read it to you, but I wouldn't make a statement like this. I've been criticized terribly, severely for making statements nowhere near as strong as this. Ellen White says, I'm going to read it to you, that when we did that, we took this position, you shouldn't accept something until the leadership accepts it, that we were tampering with, what do you suppose? Popery. Can you be tampering with popery and be accepting the three angels' messages? Let me read that to you. This is the same, this concerning the same experience. She says, we are years behind, and yet men in responsible positions will in their blindness keep the key of knowledge, refusing to enter themselves and hindering those who would enter. The message must be broadcast that those who have been imperceptibly tampering with popery, not knowing what they were doing, may hear. They are fraternizing with popery by compromises and by concessions which surprise the adherents of the papacy. Stand out of the way, brethren. Do not interpose yourselves between God and His work. Now, let's think that through. She says the adherents of the papacy were actually surprised at what we were doing. What were we doing? We were telling people, don't accept any message that you hear preached or taught until you've been told it's okay by the leaders. And White says that's cruelty to the Spirit of God. You're tampering with popery. They're surprised that you're following down the same way that they're going. We're going to have to get out. We're going to have to learn the lesson of Minneapolis, friends. We haven't learned it yet. We've got the very same thing all through Adventism from the top to the bottom all over the world today. I've been in the system, friends. I know what I'm talking about. We have not yet learned the lesson from Minneapolis because we're doing the very same thing all over the world. People say, well, these lawsuits are terrible. Well, I agree. But friend, the lawsuits, that's just a symptom. That's not the problem. That is a symptom of the underlying problem. And the underlying problem is tampering with popery. The idea that the Church of God must be controlled by men or a group of men, whether it's one man or a group of men, doesn't make any difference. We will never receive the Holy Spirit with that kind of theology, philosophy, actions, behavior. James White used to say the Holy Spirit is our King. Did you know that James White told ministers that they were not to place themselves in the arms of the conference committee? They're not to just do whatever the conference committee told them to. He said that would be disloyalty to Christ. You're supposed to follow the Lord. Totally opposite of what we're teaching our ministers today. We haven't learned the lesson of Minneapolis yet. Let me ask you this question. Do you believe that in Adventism we are going to receive the Holy Spirit with power when we have not yet learned the lesson from 1888? Do you think that's going to happen? If any church wants to receive the Holy Spirit with power, are we going to have to learn the lesson from 1888? Are we going to have to learn the lesson that they didn't learn? I want to read to you a couple of statements that were written by Ellen White in 1891. This is still talking about the necessity of separation. She says, they, that is our people, should not place themselves in connection with any man that has pursued the course of evil that he has done, whatever may be his calling or apparent success, for in thus doing, they make themselves serve with his sins, and the Lord is not pleased with their course of action. The Lord's Spirit has been grieved. Here's another one, this same manuscript. There is caution to be exercised. Now we cannot come into willing association and intercourse with the workers of evil unless we catch their spirit. What about people in the church that are not converted? Ellen White addressed this statement. I read this statement probably 10 or 15 years ago when I was preaching at a large meeting in Southern California. There were other Adventist ministers there and other laymen there that did not agree with me. And so I was challenged when I read it. I was challenged right from the floor that somehow there needed to be more context because they didn't feel that the statement made sense. They just could not believe this. I've read this statement over and over again. It's found in several places. It's found in the Paulson Collection, page 8344, if you have that collection. It was written to S.N. Haskell, one of our ministers. I can't read to you all the context. That would take our whole time. It's several pages. But Ellen White was writing to S.N. Haskell talking about the fact that we have people in our church that are not born again. They're not converted. They haven't received the Holy Spirit. And this is what she says. They simply have the name of Christians but are not fitted for the work of God and never will be until they are born again and learn the ABC and true religion of Jesus Christ. There is a little hope in one direction. Now, this is what people objected to when I read this part. Take the young men and women and place them where they will come as little in contact with our churches as possible, that the low grade of piety which is current in this day shall not leaven their ideas of what it means to be a Christian. What did Ellen White say to do? By the way, let me ask you this question, just as a thought question. Do you think the condition of Adventist churches today is better or worse than it was in 1892? In 1892, it was bad enough that Ellen White said, there's a little hope if you take the young people and place them where they will come as little in contact as possible with our churches so they do not get led astray on what it really means to be a Christian. You see, this is the hard part. We didn't go all this hard material this morning. This is what people don't want to hear. They don't want to believe because we're social beings. Nobody wants to be alone. No, people want to be with... By the way, do you know that there are many people right in Wichita that have come to our meetings, prophecy seminars, but they don't come to church here. You know why? They want a church that's big enough so that there's more social opportunity in the church. But the people that are ready for Jesus to come are going to be a little flock that is separate from all these other groups that are not living according to the law of God. And people say, well, Pastor John, doesn't it say that the wheat and the tares are going to grow together until the harvest? Well, yes, it does. But the question is, when is the harvest? Are we living in the time of harvest right now? Well, we are. I want to read to you a prophecy that Ellen White made concerning the future. I believe it's right now, but in her day it was in the future. And what was going to happen in the harvest time. Now, this is in the 1888 materials, page 995. And this is what Ellen White said was going to happen. This is a prophecy. It wasn't right then. You'll see in the second sentence, it's a prophecy. She's predicting what's going to happen in the future. She says, I see perplexities on every side. As character develops, man and woman will take their position, for varied circumstances brought to bear upon them will cause them to reveal the spirit which prompts them to action. Everyone will reveal the character of the bundle with which he is binding himself. The wheat is being bound up for the heavenly garner. The true people of God are now bound up for the heavenly garner. The true people of God are now pulling apart. And the tares are being bound in bundles ready to burn. Decided positions will be taken. And then she goes on to explain the people that will be bound in tares, together as the tares. And this is what she says on page 1002. She says, dark hours of trial are before the church because they have not obeyed the warnings and reproofs and counsel of God. What a bewitching power comes upon human minds to do contrary to the oft-repeated will of God and close the eyes and stop the ears when Jesus is calling to them to hear his voice. The dark hours of trial are to come to everyone as a part of his education for higher work, for a more devoted, consecrated effort. Before the great trouble shall come upon the world, such as has never been since there was a nation. And that's still future. Those who have faltered and who would ignorantly lead in unsafe paths will reveal this before the real vital test, the last proving comes, so that whatsoever they may say will not be regarded as voicing the true shepherd. Now, friends, I believe that's happening right now. That's page 1002. The people that would ignorantly lead in false paths are revealing it right now. And you need to pay attention to who's teaching what, so that you'll know who not to pay attention to. Lead you astray. God himself is the one that's drawing a dividing line. Ellen White wrote in 1900 that God himself is not now drawing the separating line. And she also wrote in 1900, she said, vice is not to be commingled with virtue, and the cry may have to go forth in no measured tones even now while missionary work is being done. Come out from among them and be ye separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So, you know, friends, there's no middle ground back to heaven. There's just one way. And you can't take a shortcut, take a different way and reach your destination. What is the middle ground that people try to take where it won't work? The middle ground is when you take what God says and say, yes, I'm going to do that, and you then try to amalgamate that with worldly plans and ideas. You try to put the two together, and it won't work. This is how Ellen White described that, and I wanted you to see in this statement what this amalgamation is. See if you recognize anything like this being done. She says, there is no middle path to paradise restored. The message given to man for these last days is not to become amalgamated with human devising. We are not to lean upon the policy of worldly lawyers. We're not to lean upon the policy of worldly lawyers. You ever heard of anybody in God's work leaning on policy of worldly lawyers today? Do you know what is predicted will happen to us if we do that? This is the same right next paragraph. This is what will happen if we do that. She said, those whom God has exalted to high positions of truth may turn from heaven's light to human wisdom. Their light will then become darkness. Their God-entrusted capabilities a snare, their character an offense to God. God will not be mocked. And she goes on to say, if we do this, God will not accept us unless we come back and thoroughly repent and confess of what we've done. By the way, don't misunderstand. I'm not claiming that anybody's committed the unpardonable sin. We could repent and confess and come back and be accepted of the Lord, but it's going to take a repentance and a thorough confession and a changing and forsaking of our ways if that's going to happen. She says, all who would possess a character that would make them laborers together with God and receive the commendation of God must separate themselves from the enemies of God and maintain the truth which Christ gave to John to give to the world. Well, It seems that there are some that are determined. We human beings sometimes are stubborn. They're determined that they're going to do the work this way. And concerning that, Ellen White wrote, this is in 1904, she said, there is to be a turning and an overturning, but our work is not to stop. We are to instruct and enlighten those who have not heard the truth for this time. At this crisis, all are called upon to take their position. We must stand apart from those who are determined to make shipwreck of the faith. People that are trying to combine the Lord's methods with the worldly methods, we have to stand apart from that. If we do that, we will never receive the Holy Spirit. We'll never be able to finish the work. The Lord will finish the work with somebody else. Ellen White makes very strong statements. I read a few about the necessity of separating from sin, from sinners, from all groups, organizations that are involved in sin. Here's one. She says, I am instructed to say that we must do all we possibly can for these deceived ones. Their minds must be freed from the delusions of the enemy. And if we fail in our efforts to save these erring ones, we must come out from among them and be separate. And then this one that she wrote in 1906. In the representations the Lord has given me, I have seen those who follow their own desires, misrepresenting the truth, oppressing their brethren, and placing difficulties before them. Characters are now being developed, and men are taking sides, some on the side of the Lord, Jesus Christ, some on the side of Satan and his angels. The Lord calls for all who will be true and obedient to his law to come out of and away from all connection with those who have placed themselves on the side of the enemy. Now, who is it that has placed themselves on the side of the enemy? Well, it's the people. It's the people that she's been just been talking about that are trying to oppress their brothers, going to worldly lawyers to do it. Now, the devil knows something that somehow some Christians don't seem to know. See, we're in a great controversy. The great controversy is not just out in the world. The great controversy is right in the church. And I want to read to you what the devil knows that some Christians don't seem to know. It says, the enemy knows, this was written in 1899, that if the church can be controlled by political enactments, she will lose her garments of light as did Adam and Eve. Now, when these lawsuits started going a few years ago, I said to myself, I didn't preach about it, I just was thinking to myself, when you start to sue somebody else, the Lord's not going to protect you from being sued back by somebody else. Now, don't misunderstand. At Steps Life, we're not suing anybody. We're determined we're not going to. Don't think that we haven't had opportunity. We've been encouraged and told that in certain situations where we've been wrong, that we could take the people to court and that we had a case and that they didn't have a good case. But we said, no, we're not going to do that. And we don't plan to ever be involved in that. We believe that's the way to lose the Holy Spirit. But if you sue others, then you can be sued in return. Just read papers and you'll find out right now that that's in process. It's been reported just in the last week or two. More lawsuits underway against the church. It says, if he, that's the devil, can lead the church to unite with the world and accept worldly enactments, they virtually acknowledge him, that's the devil, as their head. That terrifies me. Do you want it to be acknowledged by the whole universe that you have acknowledged the devil as the head of your church? If your church is controlled by political enactments, by government decrees, by law courts, by all the legislation, all these things, if that's what's leading your church, you've acknowledged the devil as your head. Are you going to receive the Holy Spirit and finish the work? No, you're not. Well, those are just a few statements that Ellen White wrote about how instead of getting ready to receive the Holy Spirit and finish the work, we're going the opposite direction. Do you want Satan to be the head of your church? Well, no. What is preventing Adventism from receiving the Holy Spirit in power? Oh, friends, God will not be trifled with. When God gives us instruction in His Word, we cannot ignore it and then receive the Holy Spirit. Why can't we understand this? Adventists have been saying for 150 years to the people of other churches, if you want to be in harmony with God and the Bible, you need to keep God's law. Well, that's true. Well, then, if it's true for them, is it true for us? Do we need to live by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God too? Friend, the Lord wants to give us the Holy Spirit more than we want to receive it, but we're not ready to receive it. Won't you go home and start praying about this? Pray about your own feelings. Do we have feelings? By the way, when I talk about our feelings, I'm not just talking about the feelings we have toward each other in our church. Do we have bitter feelings or hard feelings towards somebody in a conference church? Is that going to keep us from receiving the Holy Spirit? Well, of course it is. The Holy Spirit cannot work in power until He has a people who are obedient to the law of God and whose feelings are in harmony with heaven. And God's going to have a people like this. that the question is not whether God's going to have a people. He is going to have a people. But the question is, am I going to be part of it? That is the question. Am I going to be part of it? Are you going to be part of it? Well, that's up to you. That's up to me. Are we going to go to the Lord and say, Lord, help me that my thoughts, my feelings, my words and actions are correct, are in harmony with heaven? You can't have hard feelings against your mother or your father or your sister or somebody else and receive the Holy Spirit. That's not possible. Your feelings have to be correct, and your life has to be in harmony with the law of God if you're going to receive the Holy Spirit. And we need to pray that our thoughts and our feelings will come into a condition where we can receive the Holy Spirit with power, and the Lord can use us. So then people walk through the door, they see a group of people that are in unity and harmony like something they've never seen before in this world, and they say, this is something I've never seen or heard of, and I'd like to be part of this. Let's pray before we go. Father in heaven, we thank you for the instruction in your word concerning the desire of Jesus, our Savior, to give to each one of us the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we also, when we study this subject, we are terrified when we see how we have gone in the wrong way. Our thoughts and our feelings have not been in harmony with heaven. We have had hard feelings and hard thoughts against this one and that one in our family or in the church or somewhere else. That has made it impossible for the Holy Spirit to work in power on our behalf. And we have tried to take your work sometimes into our own hands in imitation, tampering with popery. Lord, I intercede for your people around the world, and I pray that you'll help us to understand what we have done that is keeping your Holy Spirit from working among us to finish the work so that Jesus can come. And I pray that as we search our own hearts, that you will help us, that we may not harbor any feelings that will prevent the Holy Spirit from working in our families or in our church. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.